Think One Team, an inspiring fable and practical guide for managers, employees, and jellybean lovers by Graham Winter, was narrated by Mark Meadows. About the author. Graham Winter is a psychologist and business consultant who has worked with top national and international leaders and teams in business and elite sport. His appointments and experiences include 6 years as exclusive designer and developer of high-performance leadership programs for PricewaterhouseCoopers Consulting in the Asia Pacific, 3-time chief psychologist for the Australian Olympic team, director of Graham Winter Consulting, author of High Performance Leadership, John Wiley & Sons 2002, and designer of the Think One Team and High Performance Leadership programs. Over the years, Graham has worked with hundreds of organizations, all battling at some point to get past the individual agendas of people and business units to capture the potential of being one team. Graham consults directly to corporations and through alliance partners who are certified to facilitate Think One Team and high-performance leadership programs. He lives with his wife, Carol, and sons, Mark and Ben, in Adelaide, South Australia. Graham can be contacted through www.thinkoneteam.com. Introduction. Imagine the possibilities when everyone in your organization thinks and acts as one big team. This proposition is based on the experience that most organizations, both big and small, are populated by little kingdoms that don't collaborate with each other. Call them what you like. Silos, stovepipes, or fiefdoms, they are enemy number one of the business world because they add to costs, irritate customers, frustrate employees, derail mergers and alliances, and are the root cause of countless lost opportunities. Ironically, it is not the silos themselves that are the problem, but rather the inability of organizations, or more particularly the people in them, to foster teamwork across boundaries. In an increasingly networked world, there is much to be said for giving business units the sort of focus that comes from being a silo. However, few, if any, can genuinely succeed without the ability to open the doors and windows of their silo to collaborate with others on problems and opportunities. This book and the related Think One Team program have been specifically designed to help you and everyone in your organization to create and sustain the teamwork across boundaries that will enable you to experience the rewards of working as one team. Beginning with the fable of the big jellybean team, you will join one company's engaging, enlightening, and at times funny journey from silo-afflicted to one team. From its experiences, you will learn the 5 practices that define the difference between think silos and think one team, and see what these practices mean for leaders and employees across an organization. From the vivid story, a Think One Team model is built, which you will find easy to understand and apply to your organization. This model will give you a language to share across the business and lots of ideas for thinking and acting as one team. It is important to stress that Think One Team means being accountable, having clear boundaries, and allowing for specialization. It is not a call to make your business one big department, because that will create the poison of bureaucracy. Rather, it is a simple yet powerful message to build the effective and enduring partnerships needed among the people of your organization to successfully implement the business strategy. Think One Team is both a mantra and a philosophy of work, because it offers a more productive and enjoyable way to live and work. The story of the Big Jellybean Team. Once upon a time, in a now fashionable inner city district of Sydney, Australia, a business called O'Donnell's Jellybean Company became the market leader in the confectionery industry. Founded by brothers William and Walter O'Donnell on their return from the Second World War, O'Donnell's Jellybean Company was enormously proud of its 50-year-plus history, its role as an employer of people from the local community, and its profitability. Most of all, however, the people of O'Donnell's Jellybean Company were proud of its products. It had been that way since William and Walter produced the first jellybeans in the kitchen of their home in Birchmore Street and sold them to children in the neighbouring streets. O'Donnell's, as the business came to be affectionately known, produced the best-looking, best-tasting, and best-value jelly beans that money could buy. Any kid who lived near Birchmore Street could tell you that money spent on those monster-sized O'Donnell's jelly beans was a far superior investment to the bland fare at the local store, which carried all the brand lollies. Importantly, an O'Donnell's jelly bean commanded a greater price when on-sold at school. Many children doubled their pocket money by investing in a few of those precious jelly beans and then selling them for a handsome profit at recess. The fame and profitability of William and Walter's jelly beans spread through the schools across the city, and in a few months a small manufacturing plant was created at a site that has since grown to accommodate the nearly 500 employees of O'Donnell's Jelly Bean Company. When you bought the real McCoy jelly bean, as Walter loved to call it, you could choose between the three colours, red, blue and black, that O'Donnell's now manufactures in a gleaming state-of-the-art factory. The enormous jelly beans, about the size of a bird's egg, were sold in clear cellophane packs of 5, 10 or 15, containing the one colour of the customer's choice. The first jelly bean ever sold by William and Walter was red, so the teams on the red production line were suitably proud that not only did they produce the lowest cost jelly bean, but also that theirs was the original real McCoy jelly bean. The blue jelly bean has always been the most attractive, with its sky blue coating and light blue inside, giving what the blue production teams called the sapphire look. Last, but never least, was the black jelly bean, which, if you ask the black production teams, was the most popular choice of customers, the source of much media coverage and clearly a better bean. O'Donnell's never sold a pack of jelly beans with the three colours combined. Why? There were three simple reasons, and they had stood the test of time. First, to sell them separately enticed customers to buy more than one pack, and the sales figures supported this view. Many a shopkeeper would tell the story of a mother and her children engaged in passionate debate over the need to buy a packet of each so that the full range of O'Donnell's taste sensations could be enjoyed. Second, William and Walter always believed that the unique flavours of the three beans would be lost if you put them together in a sealed packet. Finally, no one needed to put those jelly beans together because year on year the company grew in revenue, profits and employees. Until, as they have a habit of doing, things changed. G'day. They say that Sydney has the most beautiful harbour in the world, and it sure looks like it from the left side window seat as you fly into Kingsford Smith International Airport from the west. The Opera House and Coat Hanger Bridge are closer than I'd remembered, and more boats are now sprinkled across the sparkling bays and inlets. As a 40-something surfer, I always think sharks when I see that harbour. Did you know that more people have been attacked by sharks in Sydney Harbour than any other place in Australia? With over 4 million people living under our flight path, I guess that's a lot of potential swimmers and shark bait. 5 years on the road is a long time. Last year, I flew the equivalent of 20 times around the planet. Mostly New York to London return, spiced up with the occasional whirlwind trip to Shanghai and Dubai. Leading a consulting outfit is fun, but high demand on everyone and everything. My speciality is big teams. Not those little departmental teams, but whole organisations and big joint ventures. Corporations, governments, sporting clubs and associations, universities and even symphony orchestras. If they really want to unleash the phenomenal power that comes from being one big team, then my team will help them to create the teamwork across boundaries that will make it happen. Australia is home. Not Sydney, actually. I'm originally from Adelaide, a rather English city of parks, hills and stunning beaches. Best place in the world to live. I'll be spending time there getting our next generation of products together, ready to take on the greatest of challenges, engaging corporate China to think one team. I'm Nick Fox. I love jelly beans, Indian food, beaches, and the awesome power of big teams. This story is my way of sharing a few insights from the road about what might just happen to you and your organization when everyone from the boss to the newest employee lives and breathes the mantra, think one team. Chapter 1. Real Conversations. Tuesday, 8:58 a.m. The executive team of O'Donnell's Jelly Bean Company assembled for what promised to be anything but the usual 9 a.m. executive meeting. Walking to the boardroom from their plush offices, the team members crossed a foyer dominated, tastefully, by two identical displays of three 2-meter-tall crystal cylinders on either side of the automatic glass entry doors. Each cylinder was full to the brim with those monster O'Donnell's jelly beans, red closest to the street, then black, then blue. As you enter the O'Donnell's building, those jelly bean cylinders escort you like a guard of honour towards Susan, the ever-smiling receptionist. An inconspicuous glass lid sits firmly atop each cylinder to ensure that no one samples from the display. Floor lights project upwards to complete the striking effect. By 9 a.m., everyone was seated. Cups of coffee and bottles of water sat on coasters to protect the lush wood-grained table, the compulsory three dishes of jelly beans in the middle of the expansive table, and papers at the ready. Like most businesses, the O'Donnell's executive team was made up of the heads of each of the six key divisions: operations, covering manufacturing and logistics; sales and marketing; research and development; human resources; corporate services, finance, information systems and administration; and customer services, currently without a head of the division. The other member of the team, Charles Enright, was appointed chief executive officer less than 3 years ago through the Sydney Old Boys Network after an unspectacular reign as head of a brand retailer. The position had become available due to the sudden death of the previous CEO, and Charles's employer had been delighted to give an all-too-glowing reference to a local headhunter who then convinced the O'Donnell's board to offer him the job. An accountant by profession and with no experience in the confectionery industry, Charles was rumoured to have confirmed more than once to his Saturday golf colleagues that "O'Donnell's is lucky to have me." No one needed the rumour to confirm Charles's arrogance. Since Charles's arrival, O'Donnell's executive meetings had been tediously predictable, with each manager reporting on successes in his or her areas of responsibility and some general discussion about low-level issues such as car spaces and office layout. Anything remotely controversial or strategic, if it was discussed at all, was left to one-on-one meetings behind closed doors with Charles or, if necessary, between the individual members. "If it ain't broke, don't fix it," was a Charles mantra that no one dared publicly challenge, although ironically most people thought of Charles as the most broken thing in the company. That all began to change early last year when the multinational Jellico Candy Corp parachuted into O'Donnell's most important markets, dropping sales by over 25% in just 6 months. Now, 12 months later, the sales graphs were still heading south, and only the cost savings from the first round of bitter redundancies temporarily halted the slide in profitability. Everyone waited for Charles to open what was expected to be an unpleasant and depressing couple of hours. He began in a sharp, aggressive tone, with eyes fixed on the table ahead of him, addressing the room rather than his team members in person. "Yesterday's board meeting was the most difficult in all of my time at O'Donnell's. The board is clearly of the view that the attempts to resolve the downslide of the past year have not been successful, and unless this quarter's budget is achieved, we will have to cut 25% of costs across the company. I'm personally insulted by the situation and expect this executive team to find answers or heads will roll." No one spoke. For Steve Edwards, head of operations and the newest and most articulate member of the team, it wasn't what he had expected on joining O'Donnell 6 months ago, but the business challenge didn't particularly faze him. This was a good business, with good people and good products that were just hitting a few speed bumps. What concerned him much more than the numbers was Charles's leadership style and its impact right through the business. Steve had seen executives burn the furniture to make the figures look good. Invariably, they killed the culture and the company in the process. Charles was a furniture burner, if ever he'd seen one. Steve would bide his time. There were things that could be done, and after 3 years in a bigger and more complex job in London, he more than anyone else in the room actually looked forward to the challenge. Never one to miss a chance to push his agenda, Ron Grisham, head of corporate services and self-appointed finance guru, took the opportunity while others were deep in thought to run through the numbers to support Charles. Our sales are down over 30%, and despite some productivity improvements in operations, I can't see an upside. My view is that we cut now and not wait until the April board meeting. Ron looked to Charles for a nod of approval. It wasn't there. Jimmy Goh, the energetic head of sales and marketing, gazed at Ron with a mixture of contempt and anger. This wasn't the moment to tackle Ron's relentless pessimism, but he was angry enough to take him on anyway. Just in time, Charles's clipped manner broke his thoughts. Jimmy, what's your view? A Singaporean national with a Harvard MBA, Jimmy's energy and track record of success with confectionery companies in the United States and Asia earned him respect from all but Ron. As he replied to Charles's question, more than one member of the team was pondering whether Jimmy might soon jump ship for another company with better prospects. We've revamped the advertising and PR campaign to be ready for launch early next month, and the customer loyalty program is being upgraded, so I anticipate about a 20% revenue increase on the back of that in the US, Australia, and Asia. He paused for a moment to gather his thoughts. The sales teams are up to the challenge, and if we can improve the teamwork between sales and operations, and IT delivers on the customer loyalty platform, I'm confident that we'll claw back what we've lost in market share and be ahead again within 12 months. I think we need to be careful not to overreact, particularly as the financial information we're getting is way out of date, and I think we're already trending upwards. With due respect, Jimmy, began Ron, running his hands through his thinning grey hair and bristling at the suggestion that his financial information was out of date, you haven't got within a mile of any of your sales forecasts for over a year, so why should we believe this one? Jimmy leant forward and looked him squarely in the eyes. If you understood the market instead of looking out the back window and telling us where we've already been, you'd know that forecasting over the past 12 months has been impossible because we've had a unique set of circumstances. What do you want me to do? Demotivate the sales teams by setting the bar at a level that you and your super slow bean counters think we can achieve? Ron was no match intellectually for Jimmy, and certainly not in a verbal sparring match. He knew enough not to take on Jimmy in this situation. He'd deal one-on-one with Charles and get those cuts in the sales and marketing budget that were long overdue. Watching all of this unfold was Emma Tompkins, head of research and development, and the quietest member of the executive team. She joined O'Donnell's as a food technologist, fresh from university, and was appointed to her current role 2 years ago. Emma had been a superb number two in R&D and very strong in project management and scientific rigour. A clever and insightful scientist, no one was surprised when Emma, at the age of 32, was appointed to the executive position, although to this day, she preferred delving into an experiment rather than leading her small team of highly qualified chemists and technologists. Emma sketched three-dimensional diagrams on the pad in front of her, hoping that someone else would break the silence. "Charles, are you saying that the board has given us a quarter to turn this around?" inquired Judith Corrigan, human resources executive. She wasn't going to let the meeting deteriorate into a slanging match, and, like Steve, she'd seen plenty of worse situations than this during her 20 years in HR and consulting. "Well, yes," he answered cautiously. "The chair and I expect a detailed strategy presented at the next board meeting to address the financial situation. She has also asked me to meet her separately this morning to go over our 3-month interim strategy." Despite Charles's reputation of dismissing anyone who overstepped their authority or disagreed with him in public, Judith was determined to press forward with her point of view. Okay, we seem to have two options. Either we do as Ron suggests and start working on more reductions now, or we back Jimmy to lift the sales performance. Not waiting for a reply, she turned to Steve. You've led a company that hit a hurdle and then picked itself up again. What do you suggest? Steve was taken aback that Judith had tossed the ball to him. He'd only been in the job a few months, and apart from the newness, he was acutely aware that Charles seemed threatened by his experience, which had been in a similar job to the one that Charles had failed in prior to joining O'Donnell's. All eyes focused on him, wondering whether he'd been tossed a ball or a hand grenade. It was a moment for leadership, and Steve was both a natural and a well-developed leader. He turned respectfully to Charles. Can I have a few minutes to work us through some ideas that I think are important? Charles couldn't refuse without looking weak. Just a few minutes. We have a lot to cover, was his muted attempt at keeping the upstart Steve Edwards under control. Real conversations. If you really want to know how a business is travelling, don't go to the boardroom. Go to the staff canteen. People in boardrooms can lose connection with what actually makes the organisation tick. They miss the conversations, the emotional moments and the open tensions. Things are often controlled in boardrooms because of status and agendas.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.